Christopher Nolan movies. Get ready to feel helpless for about 2 hours. Hey everybody, what's going on? Today we're going to be talking about Christopher Nolan's new movie, Dunkirk. During World War II, the Allied soldiers are trapped on the beaches of Dunkirk, France, where the German army can easily pick them off. A civilian fleet is called in to help them escape. The tagline of this movie is "Survival is victory." Now, if that doesn't scream hopelessness, what does? That is really the whole feeling of this movie. Even when this movie gives you a glimmer of hope, it quickly takes it away. And I'm not saying this is a bad thing. The entire feeling of dread and helplessness and lack of hope is what really pushes this movie forward. It really keeps it interesting because you start to feel for these characters. In a way, that's what's kind of funny about this movie is that the characters are very vague. I mean, yes, you know their names and you know what branch of the military they're in and everything else. But other than that, you don't know much about them. The real character of this movie is the entire event, the situation that these characters are in. And the situation is so dire and it's so scary that you feel for the characters anyway. When it comes to the event itself, this whole movie is like an hour and 45 minutes, yet the majority of it feels like a finale. And it's crazy how it just keeps that feeling. And, you know, everything feels like this could be the end. And that's what I mean by it feels like the finale. Yet it keeps going and going and going. And that being said, for the most part, it stays interesting the whole time. When it comes to the plot structure, even though the movie tells you this pretty much right at the beginning, it's kind of vague. So I want to go over this plot structure with you. The first one is called 1 week, which represents the soldiers that are trapped on the beach. The second one is called 1 day, which represents the civilians that are coming to get them on their boats. And 1 hour represents the fighter pilots coming to help. I felt a little dumb at the moment when it kind of came to me that this is what was going on, because I was wondering, I'm like, wait a minute, why is it nighttime now and it's daytime this time? And, you know, I spent a little bit of time thinking about that and I kind of lost just a little bit of what was going on in the movie. So if you know that going in, you don't have to think about it and you can pay more attention to what's going on. So hopefully that helps. Those of you wondering about Harry Styles in this movie, look, I know he's a singer. I couldn't tell you what group he was in or any of his songs. I can just tell you this. He's not bad in this movie. It's not like Ed Sheeran from Game of Thrones. I mean, what the hell was that? This movie deals with a ton of different themes. There's sacrifice, there's fear, there's cowardice, there's bravery. Like I said about the characters, you kind of treat them all as one character. Though there's some good characters in this, there's not a ton of well-developed characters. It's basically these characters versus a situation. That being said, if you do attach to characters, it's probably going to be Tom Hardy's fighter pilot and Mark Rylance's civilian captain, probably because their characters deal with a little bit more sacrifice than the others. I gotta say this, Christopher Nolan, you should do runtimes like this more often. This movie is lean, mean at like an hour and 45 minutes, and it's the perfect time. I do have two minor complaints about this movie. The first one is that it kind of telegraphs itself a little too much. A perfect example is Tom Hardy's character's plane, the fuel gauge breaks, and you're sitting there the whole movie going, gee, I wonder when this is going to come into play. And of course it does. I won't say what happens, but knowing that something's going to happen kind of takes away from the surprise. Like I said, though, minor complaint. My second minor complaint, and this happens in a lot of Nolan movies, is that for authenticity, Nolan often sacrifices being able to hear characters speak, so the atmosphere has certain sounds, and definitely loud sounds, or muffled sounds. I mean, there's times where the engines of planes and explosions take away from what the characters are saying. You can't understand what they're saying, kind of like it happened in Interstellar, or a character's mouth is covered up the whole time, like Tom Hardy's character, when the action's really going on, you can't really hear what he's saying. What is it about Nolan wanting to cover up Tom Hardy's mouth? That being said, these are minor complaints because the situations and everything that's happening around, you get the idea. Even though, Mr. Nolan, it would be nice to hear what they're saying every now and then. And that's my review of Dunkirk. look, this movie's not going to be for everybody. It is a war movie. It's very violent, but it's PG-13 violent. You don't expect, you know, Saving Private Ryan, you know, type of violence in this movie. It's PG-13 war violence. If you are interested in this movie, I will suggest that you do see it in the theater, only because the spectacle that is this movie deserves to be seen on a very big screen. I saw it on a deluxe screen. It wasn't an IMAX screen, but the sounds and the visuals and everything really deserve that size and that loudness. And seeing it that way, I think, is better than seeing it on a smaller screen, which I think, though the movie would still be good, I think it would lose some of that effect that it was going for. As always, thank you so much for watching. What did you think of Dunkirk? Feel free to comment out down in the section below. But remember, it's only just one guy's opinion. I'm Gino Reynolds from The Real Gino. Till next time.